As the country battles the coronavirus pandemic, Nigeria's House of Representatives has passed a bill to prevent mass retrenchment. Plus, are Nigerians getting the real figures of the new coronavirus infections? What are the reasons for the growing skepticism to the official figures? This is PLUS Politics, and I am Felicity Ezewike. Thank you for joining us. As the COVID-19 virus rages on, the House of Representatives have taken steps to protect the jobs of citizens. A bill was passed yesterday by the House stating that any organization that does not lay off its staff before the end of the year will be refunded with 50% of the income tax paid on its employees' salaries. It also seeks to suspend all import duties on medicines, medical equipment, and other essentials required in the treatment and management of COVID-19. Joining me in the studio is legal practitioner Christian Wogu. Thank you very much for joining us.
It's my pleasure. Felicity.
All right. What's your thought on this bill at this time and the expedited passage?
Yeah, I must say it's impressive that the House can pass a bill, first reading, second reading, third reading within 30 minutes. And that shows that these things are possible, because when we keep talking about these things, it looks like they are so far-fetched and unattainable. But the House has proved that, well, it can rise up to a particular challenge. Now, my challenge, my trauma, is the exact thing that he said to be giving out in the bill that is passed. And in my take, I think that the House has actually given nothing to Nigeria or Nigerians.
Why do you say that?
Yeah, because look, they are talking about something that will happen in the next 6 months if a company is able to retain staff for the next 6 months.
No, but the bill is backdated to take effect from the 1st of March. I was actually going to, that was part of the questions I was going to ask. The backdating, the month is already almost gone. How effective would that be? It's not going to wait for the next 6 months.
Yes, ideally, a law should not take retroactive effect. But, well, I think that the circumstance in which we find ourselves gives it a doctrine of necessity that has been driven by necessity. Now, assuming it's backdated to 1st of March, it will mean that it will be 6 months from 1st of March. So it's still going to be an incentive that's going to come in 6 months from 1st of March. And really, you are telling Nigerians that if they can retain their staff up till December, that they will have 50% tax rebate. Now, the question is, what is the government giving to these companies to help them retain this staff? How are they going to do it? Yes, you want to reward them after they have done something. And that's really the difference here when we want to lock down an economy and without giving a palliative, you know, helping people survive the lockdown. That's important. Now, part of their giving was that they can't do direct credit to every Nigerian. Yes, that's a challenge, and that's really the reason why we must get down to getting our data as a people, as a nation, correctly. We must start from somewhere. Now, it is a default of the past that we are experiencing today. What should have been done maybe 5 years or thereabout ago, knowing who we are.
But isn't this better than nothing at all?
Yes, it looks better, but really, what's been given? Look, you're talking about people in employment. What are people who are not in employment? You're talking about companies with data, with IRS data. What of those that don't have such data? Now, yes, it's not right not to pay tax, but look, we are in a situation where Anybody can fall. What happens to somebody that doesn't pay tax can, at this point, affect the person.
Well, the CBN has outlined a couple of measures to help small businesses manage at this time that, you know, nobody knows what the future holds as it stands today.
Let's even assume that is accurate, but I'm still to really see those palliatives and incentives CBN had rolled out. But many persons don't run businesses. So what happens to them? So because we must look at the end of the day, government is feeling great that it had done something. And don't forget that this hadn't become law yet. Because it still has to get the concurrence of the Senate concept. And the approval of the president, who will sign it into law. So, and really, this is not something I think should pass through all these processes. It should be an executive responsibility to come out with the palliatives, whether at the federal level, at the presidential level, or at the state levels. The governor here is fighting and doing his best to try and contain this coronavirus pandemic. But then the question is why people are being locked down, or why the economy is being locked down. How do the citizens survive? We need to see that aspect of responsibility from government, you know, so that it will be comprehensive, it will be complete, it will be acceptable. In fact, so that the law is, you make it easy for people to comply. Compliance is also very critical and important, because survival is the name of the game. You know, people, you must show how people will survive. So I want to say that, yes, the House had actually done some thinking, but I'm not sure they have completed the process of holistic thinking.
Well, the issue of medicine, medical equipment at this time, removing import duty, if I get that correctly, import duties on medicines and the like, you know, don't you think that is critical and a move that should be commended?
We appreciate that, but you know, we are looking at infinitesimal action being taken. Now, not everybody will contact coronavirus. So you're talking about medical equipment for people that may. I mean, if you took care of, if you gave them food to eat, if there were other types of care, you know, made available to them, there wouldn't be need even to start talking about importing. These things are necessary, that they hadn't even been imported by now. It's an issue. So we are going to wait for people to raise invoices, get from M, get the medical equipment come, and then you give them waiver.
So what measures, we'll still continue with that, but I just want to ask, what measures or laws should they be promulgating at this time, in your opinion? Because you don't seem very impressed with this bill.
Yes, I am not. It's commendable. We must say, look, some effort had been done, but this doesn't get to the spread. It's still exclusive to a large extent. That's the point we're making. So we must look at ways to make sure that people eat during this time, because they need nourishment, they need immune boosters, so that they can independently fight the disease. So anything that can be done.
We aren't at a lockdown yet. From all the comments and, you know, projections that's being made, economists say we shouldn't lock down. But I saw a story today about scientists saying we should go ahead and lock down and all of that. Banks are still working. Malls are still working. Essential goods, food items and the likes are still open to the people. So has it come to that?
No, look, Felicity, let's not take this lightly. Yes, there may not have been a complete lockdown. But take, for instance, the schools, especially in Lagos State, are shut down.
Shut
they are
down,
closed.
Yes.
That's a huge economy. You're talking about teachers, you're talking about vendors, you're talking about cleaners, you're talking about contractors. That's a great challenge. Now, the churches and the religious organizations actually also had been regulated at this point. Look, that's a whole, you know, you can't imagine the economy and how much the economy is affected, you know, by just that move. So it may not have been comprehensive, but people's salaries at the end of March are already challenged. Many people may never get their salaries at the end of March. So lockdown is not a destination, it's a process, and the process is on. The streets are getting emptier, which actually great measures in order to fight
a spread.
And it's, we must commend the capacity of, especially the governor of Lagos State, to make decisions. He has really, because decision making is key to governance. But we are saying that these decisions must have a human dimension to it, because people will also be, you might be creating a solution, and the solution now creates more problems.
Okay, let's look at something that the House Speaker, Femi Gbajabiamila, said during this process. He was part of the people that came up with the bill. He says that it's a temporary measure that they hope will help the country to more effectively manage the present crisis and emerge from it with the possibility of rebirth and renewal. You've expressed a whole lot of skepticism, even though you say it's a good move, but will it help in this process at all? Because part of what was mentioned was the fact that individual contributors to the National Housing Fund, they will be given a 6 months deferred payments for their, and that we also have the import duties for medicine, as well as the tax exemption for employers who pay salaries. All of these cumulatively, let's not look at it individually, all of these cumulatively, will it help in any way in this fight?
Yeah, it will. We don't want to say it won't. We are saying that it's not holistic enough. No, how many persons are on the National Housing Scheme or funding? So it's just exclusive. It's going to benefit, if at all, a few persons, and like what has been said here, is temporary palliative, is temporary measure. That means after this time out, all of these things will still have to be paid. We don't know whether, Felicity, we are saying the governments have started thinking, we must give it to them. But we want something holistic that can come down to the basic person in the Nigerian economy, the youth, the unemployed, the people that don't have capacity and documentations, to assess some of these things, and they're in the majority. You might find that the people that can benefit from this may just be.
Do you believe the government can come up with a plan?
Oh, definitely. That's why they are there, by the way. That's why we put them there. So it's not a matter of my belief. It's an obligation. It's a duty. It's a responsibility. They need to sit down and come up with something, that can, flow down and benefit everybody. And you could really sit down and say, of a truth, we've got government.
Okay, the speaker mentioned the crucial point that Nigeria has, we don't have a robust health system, and our infrastructure at best is, let me just use that expression. And he says, if we have a large-scale spread, it will affect family finances, especially like you highlighted, some that don't have any recourse or they don't have a way to get to the government to get these payments. So all the measures that has been announced so far by the government, are they looking, like they will help in any way to address this situation, or it's only going to favor a certain group of people and be disadvantageous to the others?
Yes, that's exactly the point I've been underscoring. Now, one of the issues you raised, the speaker said about not having particularly enough data, to be able to do cash transfers to people, that just shows a huge default in governance. Large lacuna. Now, but again, my challenge is whether the people in charge of government will accept this as a challenge and start from somewhere. That may even be more of a consolation. If they come up and say, look, we have found out that our medical facilities are not enough, and we are beginning from today to put them in place, and we are starting from this point, and this is how far we're going to go, and that's where we're going to arrive. Now, that's going to be more like, you will see a proactive measure. even though at the end of the day it's still reactive. But you see that within the context of reaction, there is an action that is being taken. We are not seeing that. And then in terms of data, to say, look, we find that the way things are, if this thing gets out of hand, because that's what everybody wants to prevent, is getting out of hand. Let's start immediately, you know, to do some kind of data. We did it in terms of registering to vote. You know, there was some kind of activity to
once
show.
There is a will, basically.
Yes, there is a will,
that we
and that's what
it.
We want to see.
Okay,
and we have to see.
You do agree that there's some benefits to this bill. So I'm going to ask you, how effective will expedited passage be for it, its effectiveness? Will it enhance it? Will it diminish it? Does it matter when it gets passed into law? Because as it stands, there's need to be concurrence from the Senate and assent from the President.
Well, we can only conjecture and presume and assume at this point, because you see that process, now the House had been diligent in ensuring that this emergency bill was passed within 30 minutes. We must comment that because so it doesn't look like we are
witch-hunting
the house. No, we want a great Nigeria. We believe that we can get a great Nigeria. Now, we don't know how long it will be. We just hope by maybe in the next, again, 24 hours, the Senate can come out and say, look, we have concord.
No, they're going on a break. All the houses are going to, both houses are going to be on recess until the 4th of April.
Yeah, but so they say if there's emergency situation, they can actually do some tele.
But this bill was already before the House, before they went on the break. So wouldn't that affect it?
I wish they could have passed it. But right now, we don't have a law. We have a passed bill. There's a huge gap in between. So until we have it as a law, and then we now see how it's being implemented and executed, that's how we can see how effectual, how effective truly it is. And the sooner that is done, so that if the House or the Senate or even the President, because the President, by virtue of executive powers, can come up with programs, you know, that can support all of this. We assume that the House has taken some steps, you know, so that when we now see it in a demonstrated performing format, we can now make conclusions.
Okay, let's look at the argument for and against the closure of plenary at this time. We see in other climes that the houses are still sitting. The U.S. House sat and just passed a humongous amount of money to help with the situation. Should the House be going on recess at this point? What's the argument for? Because, I mean, we're all human beings. There is self-preservation and all of that. What is the argument for the closure and against the closure, in your opinion? Which stands higher?
No, very much so. I don't mind if the House goes on recess, but they should not, a matter of go to, for, but in any case, they said it's not a break. They're not going on break. So really, they can work remotely. They should be able to work remotely with all the votes and all the money that is put at their disposal. They should be able to come up with resolutions remotely. I don't think there's any law that says if it's remotely done and they take their votes, that it will not count.
Well, the Vice President is already working remotely after going on self-isolation. But as a wrapping thought for this, what's your general overview of the efforts that our government has put in place compared to, let's not go to the European nations now, let's look at Africa, where the giants of Africa, allegedly. So in comparison to the efforts by other government, how would you rate our government?
Apparently, Felicity, I would say that this challenge caught Nigeria napping. And so they could only do the best somebody that suddenly woke up from sleep in emergency can do. I don't want to compare Nigeria to any nation. I'm just saying that if we put our acts together, we can beat all of these. There will be no basis for comparison at all. I would just want to leave it at that.
We do have hope still.
Certainly.
Thank you very much
for coming
on the program.
You're welcome, Felicity.
All right, we'll take a quick break. And when we return, questions to ask as regards the outbreak and the spread of the virus in Nigeria when it comes to new figures released by the government. Stay with us.